it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, to my knees or will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine.
Hi, welcome to I Believe in Miracles with Dave and Patty Loggy. We're here every Monday night from 9 to 10 p.m. and we have different guests on every week. We tell about different miracles that are happening, that, you know, God's still doing miracles today. And we have Mark McClinton, or
McClendon.
McClendon, I'm sorry.
That's all right, close enough.
With us tonight. And we've known you for what, about 6 months or 9 months now?
I'd say probably closer to a year.
Oh, is it? Okay. Yeah. Okay, lose track. Time flies,
yeah,
doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Well, we want to talk about different miracles that are happening, and we have different ones every week. You know, we're mm-hmm. praying for somebody. God brings somebody across our path, and I know that He's done that for you too. So why don't you just tell us a little bit about yourself and tell us some of the things that have happened to you.
Well, yeah, I'm just glad to be here and be able to share what the Lord's done in my life. But I was born in Texas in 1967 in Houston. Shortly after that, we moved to Lufkin, Texas, where my family is from. Mm-hmm. And lived there until I was, until 91, and moved up here to Iowa. Mm-hmm. But I was raised in First Assembly of God Church in Lufkin, and yeah. when I was 13, when we went to church camp, that's when I gave my life to the Lord and started seeking the Lord at that time. So,
yeah,
wasn't long Good. After that, my parents divorced, and I went to live with my dad, who wasn't a Christian, uh-huh. and got to running around with the guys, you know, and doing the things I shouldn't have been doing.
Sure.
So yeah, I just pretty much stayed away from church and all that stuff. I've got three great kids, a son and two daughters. Last November, my wife decided she wanted something different and asked for a divorce. And I knew at that point I couldn't make it through that by myself. So I hit my knees and rededicated my life to the Lord, and my life's never been the same since. So it's been a good ride. The Lord's blessed me in a lot of ways in the last year and 9 months. So.
Well, good. And what are some of the things that that God's been doing to you and through you for other people?
Well, just a few things the Lord's done. My mom, she lives in Houston, and she had called, and a friend of hers, her husband was in the hospital. It had needed stents in his heart, and he just really didn't want to go to the hospital, and it was really getting bad, so finally he did go. And my mom had called me and said he wasn't doing real well, and mm-hmm. asked if I could pray for him, and I said, sure, you know. So once I got off the phone with her, I started praying for him, and mm-hmm. and just immediately, I saw a vision, and I saw this man laying in his hospital bed, and I saw Jesus walk up to the side of the bed, and mm-hmm. he grabbed his hand, and with his left hand, he waved it over his body from his head all the way down to his feet.
Wow.
Then he leaned over and kissed him on the forehead.
Oh.
And the thing that really stuck out was when he leaned over to kiss him on the forehead, how his hair brushed his face. And I don't know what the significance of that was, but it just really stood out.
Wow.
And so, so I knew the Lord had done something special there. Mm-hmm. So I called my mom a couple of days later and asked her how this guy was doing. And she was just ecstatic that how things had went. He had had a problem. He's a big, tall man. He spent most of his life in the military. He's like 6'5", 6'6", and just proud guy, you know, and walk straight and everything. Mm-hmm. And he'd had a problem. I guess when you have heart problems, it gives you a tendency to walk kind of bent over. But she said when he left the hospital that after 10 years, he was able to walk straight up, you know, and just like he had just walked out of the military. So, so yeah, that was a blessing, you know, and especially that the Lord would show me that. You know, and when he did, I knew that God had touched that man's life. So
I don't know if everybody gets those kind of pictures that God shows to everybody that. Well, so that's
I feel just, real fortunate.
Yeah.
So you're in Iowa and you prayed for somebody in Houston, Texas.
Yep.
And God still answered that prayer. The guy walked out of the hospital the next day.
You bet. God knows no bounds.
Amen.
So, yeah, it's been great. You know, and when he showed me that, I just felt like the Lord was using me in a way that I never had imagined. Mm-hmm. You know, and I hadn't been walking with the Lord that long, and I wasn't expecting that, but I had... I'd totally given my life to the Lord and asked him to use me in any way that he wanted. Because mm-hmm. I just want to live for him every day. And whenever I did that, that's what he chose to use me with. So I'm really blessed that way.
Yeah.
And you was telling me a while back you had a visitation in your room.
Which time are we talking about on this one?
Didn't you say you seen it realer than real when Jesus walked into your bedroom?
Well,
I thought that was you that had a visitation, a vision.
One of the things I was in my room praying, and that's my special place, you know, that I spend time with the Lord. But I'd asked the Lord, you know, to use me, you know, and in any way that he saw fit. And I have this passion for people that are hurting. Probably not to get away from the subject, but probably a year before I rededicated my life to the Lord, I would be watching TV. And if I seen a commercial where these kids in these other countries were suffering, you know, it would just well up in my heart. And I'd almost start crying. I thought, you know, or see an act of compassion. I would just well up in my eyes. And I'm like, is there something wrong with me? Why is this all of a sudden happening? You know, and I would just fight it back, you know, because it just wasn't what I thought was natural for a man to be sitting there watching something like that, you know. And I just really thought something was wrong with me. But after I'd rededicated my life to the Lord, anytime the Lord wants to speak to me, the Holy Spirit will well up in my heart. And as you guys know, you better have a box of Kleenex handy. But no, I was, you know, I was in my room praying, and I had asked the Lord to show me how to pray. And as soon as I spit those words out of my mouth, my body just started shaking uncontrollably. And I found myself walking up some stairs to a second level in a construction site. And I saw a construction worker laying on the ground. And there were several people around him. And I asked, I said, what's wrong with him? And they said, he's dead. He got electrocuted. I said, no, he's not dead. He's sleeping. They said, no, he's dead. So I walked over there and leaned over and put my hand on his chest and on his head, and I leaned over. But I don't know what I said to him. But wow. I told him, I said, no, he's not dead. He's just asleep. And I said, get up. And he got up. And instantly the vision was gone and the shaking was gone. You know, but it's just amazing. What God will do for you.
Have you ever found out who that is?
No, I haven't. And I was thinking, you know, I work in a factory type setting. And a lot of time we have contractors come in And I kept thinking, is this going to happen, you know, when I'm working, you know? Because if it is, I know just what to do, you know? Go up there and lay hands on them and tell them to get up. So yeah.
And we've had several other friends that have done that in the last year or two.
Yeah.
Wow.
And when you were speaking of it, I think that somebody was actually touched. You've got a gift about praying for people long distances. I think God wanted somebody to intercede.
Yes.
When I first got into this about 8 years ago, I got all the books I could on miracles, and that happened one time to a bunch of missionaries. All of a sudden, they were out playing the people in this country that were backing them. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, all had to go to church and pray, and they found out later the missionaries were being attacked by the natives, and they found out later that every one of them intercessors had sent an angel because they couldn't attack them because they had these big warriors around their camp.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So keep up the good work.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So. I have to tell a story that happened last week. God is just so good. Sometimes when it seems like life is really hard and you don't know what to do, that's when God can show up the biggest, you know? And so last Sunday night, a week ago Sunday night, I was having a really hard day. And, you know, we have our meetings every Sunday night, and I didn't go. I just couldn't. I just had a lot of stress from every angle. And it was like, I just felt really down. And I asked God, and he released me that I didn't have to go to the meeting. And so I didn't go, and I told Dave, and I just spent some time with a couple girlfriends, and we actually ended up interceding and praying for somebody during that time. So I guess God will use you wherever you're at. But I just had a hard week all week, and I just cried out to God on Friday, and it's like, God, I can't do this. I can't do this. Our financial situation is not real good, and it's just, God, where are you at? You know, I don't understand. And so Friday afternoon, Dave said he was going to go to a meeting. It was a Full Gospel Businessmen's meeting, and I said, I'm not going. I'm just taking some time to myself, and, you know, go ahead and go, but I'm not going. And so he called the guy that's in charge of the Full Gospel Businessmen's meeting, and he told him that it was canceled. They had Wednesday and Thursday night, they had the meeting, and there wasn't a lot of people. And so Dave asked if he could talk to the lady. God led him to call her, and so he did. And he asked her if we could meet with her, and she said either Friday evening or Saturday morning. And so Dave calls me back and says, what do you think, you know, do you want to meet with her? And I'm in my mind, I'm thinking, no, I'm not doing anything. I'm taking Friday night off and Saturday day. I need some time. And so then God just led me to call her, so I did. And she was a really nice lady. We met with her Friday evening, and it's just, she was supposed to have a meeting. You know, she canceled, and she says she never does this. Hmm. And she's from Georgia. God sent somebody all the way from Georgia, she's a prophet, to talk to me, to speak into my life, to lift me up. She said, yes, God really has called you to be in the ministry. You are important. You're important in this marriage. And she just said all kinds of uplifting, edifying things, that just what I needed to hear. And she had been interceding that morning, and God told me that it was for me.
And she hadn't even met you yet.
No, she didn't know me. She didn't know who it was for.
Wow.
But when she was telling me that, I knew that it was for me. That, you know, sometimes we don't see how much God loves us, but he showed me at that point in time that he loved me that much. He sent somebody from Georgia that canceled her meeting, that met with us, that spoke into me, and interceded for me. It was just like, God, you are so good.
How long did she stay?
Oh, we met her at like 6 o'clock, went out to eat, and then she was at our house, I don't know, till probably about 11, I think.
5 hours.
Yeah. And so God is just so utterly amazing, you know? It's like, and it just lifted me up out of the junk I was in.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not so much that anything changed, but because God showed me how much he loved me. And it's just like, God, you are so good. And we just, sometimes we just take things for granted.
And the neat thing was, I met her a year and a half earlier, and I didn't know her name or who she was until we got to the restaurant. And the friend that showed her around this area, I'd met 5 years before that, mm-hmm. and there was miracles both times we met.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And I don't know names. I don't remember names of people, but, you know, once I seen her and we put two and two together, we knew that it was a divine appointment.
Yeah, that's awesome. God knows where to show up.
If we just listen, and usually I don't know why, I just knew that I had to meet her, and I couldn't let that opportunity slide by, that it was a divine appointment. I usually don't know the whole story. I just know that if I'm obedient, when God says go, go.
Mm-hmm.
The miracles happen all the time.
Yeah.
Then me and Jim went down to the International House of Prayer. People had a 2-day event, and we went, and it wasn't what we expected. Usually there's more people getting healed, saved, set free, and it was more of a teaching thing. So me and Jim, he knew some people in the neighborhood on the south side of Des Moines, and he went to see his friend, and he wasn't there, but his mom was.
Mm-hmm.
She says, well, I really don't need prayer. I don't ever get sick. I got, you know, the Holy Ghost in me. I don't get that way.
Thank you,
but
God.
My sister's on her deathbed not too far from here. I said, well, let's go. What about your meeting? I said, well, this is more important than a meeting.
Sure.
So we go over there, and we are introduced to her brother-in-law and his daughter. And the lady, they give her less than 6 months to live. The hospice had been called in to do what they could do. And we woke her up. First thing I said to her, I said, do you believe in miracles? And she just, her eyes got big. She raised her hand. The power of God hit her, and she was just vibrating in her bed. There was no long, drawn-out prayer, but...
Mm-hmm.
And you won't know the results until later. So then she wanted to go back to sleep. God was already moving, so we went back in the living room, and God started giving us words for the other people. The daughter got her lungs all of a sudden. Her lungs opened up. Her dad had stomach trouble, and he was kind of getting stiff in the joints, and the power of God hit him. Then I noticed he was missing a finger. And I haven't seen this personally yet, but I've got a lot of friends that have, that I grabbed his hand with a missing finger, and that little stump just started wiggling and shaking. And several of the people in the room says that they could see it in the supernatural grow out. So I don't know when or how, but I believe it's going to happen before too long.
Yeah.
I mean, he was just shaking and vibrating too, that you knew the power of God was hitting him. I mean, they just come alive. And that's kind of our specialty. It just, I call it shake and bake, because they're never the same again.
I just want to thank God for everything that he's doing in our lives and other people that we know, that he is here today. He's still doing miracles every time we turn around. I mean, not just people that we pray for, but everywhere. He's still alive and... Mm-hmm. And healing people and setting them free. He's just so good. He loves us so much.
Yeah.
I know you have other stories you'd like to share with us too.
Yeah, yeah. It's always good to tell what the Lord's done for us. But one of the things that happened not too long ago, a friend of mine, Cheryl, that I went to school with, hadn't spoke to her seen her, you know, since I'd moved to Iowa, and probably even some time before that, since I got out of school, probably 25 years since I've talked to her, and I've got reconnected with her. And what she does, she works for a business that if there's a kid, I believe it's a year or younger, that has mental or physical handicaps, that she'll go in and assess them and see what kind of programs that the state offers, that they can set them up, you know, to mm-hmm. help them out. And she deals with so many of these kids, you know, that all have mental or physical problems, that it's to her advantage not to get too involved with them, or it would be too much for you.
Oh, know? I could see that be hard.
Yeah. But she called me one day and was telling me about this year-old little boy. His name was Brody, that he has some intestinal problems, and his intestines were separated, and they had a bag that was connected to him. And he was losing weight really, really quick. He was getting sick, you know, whenever he would eat, and he was just losing weight, and his organs were beginning to shut down. They did take him over to Shreveport, Louisiana, to the hospital there. And they wanted to, some fluid built up around his heart. So they had him in intensive care, and she called, and she was really upset, and this had really gotten to her, you know.
Sure.
She asked me if I could pray for him, and I said, oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. So once I got off the phone with her, you know, there again, the Holy Spirit just welled up in my heart, and I just began weeping, and it's just mm-hmm. uncontrollable, and I guess really I wouldn't want to stop it, you know.
Yeah.
So, but then as I began to pray for him, I saw Jesus holding him, and the little boy had his head on Jesus' shoulder and had his arm around Jesus' neck, you know, and he said he's going to be okay. Well, immediately I thought, what do you mean he's going to be okay? Or are you taking him with you?
Yeah.
Or he's going to be okay, you're going to leave him here? You know?
Right.
So I just trusted in the Lord. You know, whatever you do, it's your will. And so I called Cheryl a couple of days later to see how Brody was doing.
Mm-hmm.
And they had taken him out of intensive care. His health had completely turned around.
Oh, wow.
And I spoke to her today or yesterday, and he's gained a lot of weight back. And they're just waiting now to see when they can schedule him for his surgery. So,
God,
praise the Lord.
So good.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it was just amazing that when he chooses to reveal himself that way, you know, because you know mm-hmm. that they're healed. You know,
yeah.
I mean, you just, there's no doubt. So it's a great feeling.
I get a question for you. A year ago, did you ever think God was going to use you so mightily?
Oh, absolutely not. You know, and I look back, and even, it's just amazing how we were talking on the way over here, how God, you know, will set things up. You
oh,
know, just
yeah.
like the lady from Georgia.
Right.
You know, and I sold a guy a car 12 years ago and didn't know him or his wife, and he invited me to church, so we went to church. They were having a revival. And I got touched by the Holy Spirit, you know, and, mm-hmm. But it wasn't long to where I'd fallen back away from church, just like I always had, you know, but whenever, the trials that I went through with my divorce, and I decided to give my life back to the Lord, the first person I thought of was the guy that I sold the car to 12 years ago. You know, that seed was planted 12 years ago.
Yeah.
Hadn't hardly seen the guy. Knew who he was, spoke to him, you know, in passing. We lived in the same town, but we very seldom saw each other. But he was the first person.
What's his name?
Oscar Dorman. You know, and the way that all works, though, is that's how I met you guys.
Yeah.
Because there was a divine meeting with you
right.
guys and Oscar.
Yeah.
And then he began bringing me with him. His wife passed away, so we kind of clung to each other, you know.
Sure.
And spent a lot of time together, so I met you guys and just submitted myself to the Lord, just mm-hmm. you know, totally give myself to the Lord, and when I did that, he knew that I was a willing vessel.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just amazing how it works in my life. You know, it is.
Yeah, Oscar, so. He's like our one of our adopted dads. We just love him dearly, and he just has meant so much to us in our life. My dad's been gone for 10 years now, and Dave's not close to his dad, and so it's so neat, and there's so many other people that are that have met Oscar, and he just gives them big old daddy bear hugs.
Yeah.
And it's just like God has given him.
What's he call them?
Oh, Jesus hugs. Yes, that's yeah. what they are. But, you know, to some people that don't have a dad, it's so nice just to get a hug from somebody. And he just, he's got so many adopted kids, and it's just so nice yeah. to know somebody. And you know that they really care. And we've met a lot of people through Oscar, and we're actually going to perform the wedding for his son and almost daughter-in-law Friday yeah. night. So we're looking forward to that.
Yeah.
So, and just, God just keeps bringing all these people across our paths, and I know you've had a lot of that too.
Yeah, absolutely. Just something that's happened recently. This acreage I rent, my landlords, the people I rent from, they're just, it was a complete God thing that I even got this house. I didn't even know it was for rent. You know, and when I found out it was right where I wanted to be, out in the country, up on the yeah. hill. You know, how much better can that be? And so I called the lady up and asked her about renting the place and asked her if there was people looking at the house. And she said yes. But she said, if you want to rent it, you can have it. I said, well, I said, maybe let's get together this evening and I'll look at it and see what, you know. So and she said, well, that's fine, but if you want it, it's yours. And so I met with
her. Did she
know you? No, I never met her before in my life. And but we met and things worked out. You know, they manage quite a few hog buildings in that area, and their machine shed is there at the property where I live, and it works for me to be there at night because they don't live in the area to kind of watch the stuff, you know, and vice versa, they watch my place when I'm at work. But they just have been a blessing to me in so, so many ways. And I was out mowing a couple of weeks ago, and, well, let me back up so I can tell you part of this blessing.
Sure.
The rent was getting tough, you know, I was kind of stretched financially, and I was starting to look for another place to live. I didn't tell them anything about mm-hmm. it, you know, but I was starting to kind of look, and I just told the Lord, I said, I'll live where you want me to live. You know, I'm not going to worry about this because I don't have to worry about it. I'm just turning it over to you. And kind of left it at that. And the girl, Cheryl, I'd spoken to her one night. And she said, so are you moving? I said, I don't know. That's not up to me. That's up to the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
You know. And but the next day, I was outside. And the lady that I rent from, her and her daughter, had come up. And I was talking to them. And I still hadn't mentioned anything about looking for another place, you know, and she says, well, we talked and we decided we're just going to lower your rent.
That said, doesn't happen.
Oh, I said, do what? She said, well, we're just going to lower your rent. And, so I said, well, to what? She said, well, Lord, to what do we have to so that, you know, you don't have to move? I said, do you know what you're saying? She said, well, yeah. I said, no, really, because I was starting to look for another place to live. I said, and I turned it over to the Lord that he would show me where he wants me to be at.
Sure.
You know, and she says, well, whatever we have to do to make it work for you to stay here, that's what we'll do.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, we don't rely on your rent, you know, so.
Wow.
So I knew that's where God wanted me to be, was right there.
Yeah.
But, you know, and that's just one of the blessings, and there's a lot of things they've done for me in that way.
Mm-hmm.
But I was out mowing the other day, and the Lord spoke to me, and he said, this is what I want you to tell them. He said, because you blessed one of my children, now I'm going to bless you in ways that you've never imagined. And the person that you've been praying for, I've heard your prayers, and I'm going to answer your prayers concerning that person.
Wow.
So I went in the house and got my phone. Of course, the old devil, he don't like that, you know.
No.
So he's whispering in my ear, you know, they're going to think you're nuts, that you're talking to God, you know. You crazy, you're going to call him? So I just hit the call button, you know. Well, that'll teach you, you know. So anyway, you know, she answers the phone, and they're Christian people, mm-hmm. you know, and I don't know to what extent, but I know they believe in God and trust in God. And I told her what the Lord told me. And she said, Mark, did you know my mother-in-law is in intensive care? I said, no, I didn't know that. And she said, you didn't know that? I said, I didn't know that, but God knows that, you know. Mm-hmm. And she said, wow, that's funny. And I said, well, the Lord just wanted me to share that with you. Mm-hmm. So I guess this wasn't that long ago. It's probably a week and a half or 2 weeks ago. But I spoke to her today and asked her how her mother-in-law was doing. Mm-hmm. She had her intestines were twisted, and she's an 88-year-old lady. And anytime you have to have surgery and you're that old, you know, yeah, the complications are really increased.
Sure.
But she said the surgery went well. She's just about back to 100%.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, you know, so. And then the thing that came to me just right after that, a day or two after that, was in the book of Acts, I believe, the story about Cornelius where the angel came to him and said, your blessings and your prayers have come up as a memorial before the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd never heard that story. And I knew immediately that that's what the Lord was telling me he was doing with them. That
right.
they're blessing me and no telling how many other people, you know,
right,
that their prayers and blessings have come before him as a memorial.
Sure.
And I heard that same story 3 days in a row, and here I'd never heard it in my life, so it just confirmed to me that,
right,
that God, you know, what God was saying. So,
right,
so, and it's awesome when you know there's confirmation and things like that.
Yeah. So. Well, we have a song that we like to play, and we just ask people to sit back and relax, and just to let God talk to you. We have such busy lives that sometimes we don't sit back and talk to him. And so we're just asking that you sit back and listen to the song. You can watch the video. It's always good. Or just close your eyes and listen and let God talk to you. We know that he's trying to talk to us, but sometimes we're not listening. So I hope you guys enjoy this song.
When I walk by your side, I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, to my knees or will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes, when I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Hi, we're back. I hope that God talked to you during that time and, you know, that you got something that you needed from him, because we know he's there. He's waiting. He wants us to listen to him. So, God, thank you so much for everything that you're doing in our lives. And just to remind you guys, every Sunday night we have a meeting in Ankeny at the Open Bible Church, and it's at 5:30, and it's Sunday evening, and the address is 1125 Southwest 3rd Street in Ankeny. And Holy Ghost leads the meeting. We have different speakers that come in every week, and we worship, and God just always shows up in a big way, and we pray for people. We have other people that are part of our core group. They pray for others, and people get healed and set free. And it's just amazing what God has done. He just loves on people all evening long. And this next Sunday, we're actually going to have the World Revival Church.
It's a two-day event.
Come up. Oh, yeah. Thank you, honey. It's Saturday at 6 o'clock in the evening is the first time they'll be there. And then Sunday morning also at 10:30 in the morning, they'll be back. And then Sunday evening at 6 o'clock this next week, it's going to be. So we know it's going to be really good, and we know God's going to show up again every time. And then 2 weeks after that, on 10-10-10, we're having, well, Maranatha's having a healing conference, and she's bringing somebody in, and so he's going to come to our meeting Sunday evening. So we know that's going to be good also. We're looking forward to that. And I'll tell you more about that next week when I have the details in front of me. Sorry.
Well, most of the people, there's very few that don't get healed.
Yeah.
And there's usually something in their life that they got to deal with yet. Like a week ago, a lady got a new kidney. I mean, there's nothing too big for God. It ain't anything we do.
Right.
But when you got people coming in expecting the miracle, their expectations up, you got a whole team of people. We try to get as many ministers and people pulling together in a team. It's open to anybody. We want to work with as many ministers as we can in the area. Yeah. When you get that many anointed people and that many people expecting a miracle, it's just like popcorn. It just, lady's neck got healed. A friend of ours had a bone where it wasn't lined up.
Oh, yeah.
Our friend Jim touched it. I said, yeah. It doesn't have to take this long. Watch this. I said, had Jim touch him, and I was on the other side of the pew after the service,
mm-hmm.
and it just went click. Jim looked. I felt something jump, and you could actually mm-hmm. see his shoulder was straight where it used to have a stair step.
Wow.
Yeah.
Just before that, another lady had a neck ache. I said, I want to show you something, because I get little blips into the future. I actually see it done before I'll go minister to somebody. It wasn't 10 seconds. I grabbed her on the neck. I think she thought I was going to strangle her. And all of a sudden, her whole head just jumps up.
You kind of surprised me.
I said, see, there's no pain, is it? You just got a new neck. It didn't take long, did it? And so many church people get into this ceremony. You got to do it this way or that way.
Right.
God already told me if I touched her, he would do it. And all I did was do what I was told to do, and bang, her neck just become whole. She got taller.
It was interesting.
And what was that lady's name? Mary?
Maranatha.
Yeah. She has just had a great healing anointing on her, and she went to a new level last night.
Wow.
And then a new guy that had never been around this, we had a lady walk in late, and I said, I don't remember now. I think Doug?
Doug, yeah.
Doug is his name. And he's a thinker, and 2 weeks ago he walks up behind me while I was ministering, and the power of God hit him, and he was just laying on the floor.
Wow.
It's kind of like God's operating table. I don't always know what to do, and most times I really don't need to.
Mm-hmm.
But he comes in all excited like a kid with a new toy, and he says, I'm writing a book. I ain't wrote a book in years, and I used to write these tech books, but now I'm going to write a godly book.
Yeah.
And it's a non-denominational book, and I said, you've got it.
Yeah.
He says, got what? You know, and this lady come in about 9 o'clock, and he just held her hands while he was speaking to her, and all of a sudden it was lights out. This lady just fell over, and then she got up, and
she was just shaken.
She was vibrating. There was something going on inside. She was just
God is doing a work in her, mighty work in her.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And I wasn't around this stuff where people fall out growing up. It was new to me the first few times. I was praying for somebody. Oh, my God, I got to call the ambulance.
Yeah. But
most of them, when they get up, they're healed. They're feeling better. Just something has changed in that.
Yeah.
And the Bible says he'll shake anything that can be shaken. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people feel like a fire goes up to them and burns something out of them. Sometimes it feels like just the oil, warm honey, it's been described as just... The love of God goes through them, and all of a sudden, they're changed forever.
Yeah,
I never know what's going to happen, but I know when we pray, something is going to happen.
Yeah, it's like when we used to meet at you guys, y'all's house in the basement. You know, it was like almost like a training ground, you know, for me to learn to hear God's voice and just to be around godly people and... That the power of God will work through. It just rubs off on you, you know. If you're a willing vessel, you know, it's going to rub off on you.
Well, it's a safe place, you know. We had it in our home for about a year and a half.
Yeah.
And people come in and they feel comfortable, you know. And now they come to the meeting and they've done it there. You know, God gives them words and they share them. And they just love on each other.
Yeah.
And it's just... It's God touching people through people. And that's what he wants, and that's what people need to be set free of their hurts and pains. You know, people have grown up and been hurt from parents or divorce, and they just need to know that people care about them.
Yeah. And I guess, you know, there was a lady there one night in the basement, and... You guys knew what was wrong with her, and you wanted to see if God would speak to one of us and tell us.
Yeah.
And there was four or five of us standing around her, just waiting to see what the Lord was going to put on our heart.
Right.
And I've got my eyes closed, you know, and I'm trying to hear God's voice. And I heard somebody say, you know what it is. And I didn't look up. Or you know what it is. I looked up and she was looking and pointing at me, and I said, well, I don't, I said, the only thing that I hear in my spirit is hip, but that don't make sense. And the lady just started crying.
Yeah.
You know, she was going to have a biopsy the next day for cancer from her hip.
Right.
You know, and that was the first time that I had heard God put that in my heart as to what was wrong with her. You know, but like I say, it's just like a training ground. And, and it taught me to step out in faith, you know, and to be able to pray for people. Hear God's voice as to what he may be speaking through me into their life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I believe the first time I came to the church, when you guys moved to the church, there was a man on the front row, and he had a brace on his leg from his knee, and it went all the way down and encompassed his foot. And several of the people had prayed for him, you know, and still at that point, I wasn't real good at just walking up to somebody and asking to pray for him or laying hands on him or what have you. But as I walked by him, I put my hand on his shoulder, and he said, yeah, I want to get this leg healed so I can get back to preaching.
Oh.
And to my knowledge, I've asked you about him before, Dave. You don't recall the man. And I've never seen him back there since. But one day, I was probably a month later, a good month later, I was at home just, you know, studying the Word.
Mm-hmm.
And the Holy Spirit welled up in me, and I just started bawling.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, what is it, Lord? I'm gonna get choked up here again. And he said, I want you to pray for that guy. And he showed me the guy, you know. He didn't have to say the guy with the brace or anything.
Right.
I knew who he was talking about. So I began praying for the guy, and I'm not a very fancy prayer, you know. I'm not good with words when it comes to praying, but God don't care about that.
No. He just sees your heart.
Yeah. you know, and I prayed for this guy, and God told me, I didn't see a vision or anything, but the Lord said, I'm healing him right now.
Mm-hmm.
And wherever that man was at, wherever he's at today, I know he's healed.
Right.
Because the Lord told me he was healed.
Yeah.
You know, but it's just a powerful and awesome thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that man will never know.
Right.
You know, but he knows that God healed him.
Right.
You know.
Yeah. I had that happen to me yesterday. Sunday morning, I just woke up and God showed me a picture of somebody that goes to the church sometimes, the Open Bible. And I hadn't seen her for a long time. And so I just started praying for her. It's like, God, I hope you get her there today. I don't know why she hasn't been there. I don't know what's going on in her life. But I just started praying for her. And when I got to church, I saw her. And that just blessed my socks off. It was like, oh, thank you, God. You know, maybe she was having a hard morning. Maybe she was just having a hard time getting ready. I don't know what the case, but God just laid it on my heart. And I was just so happy to see her there. I'm like, God put you on my heart, and I prayed for you this morning. I'm so glad to see you.
Well, what happened during church? In the lobby. Anne.
Oh, Anne, yeah. Another lady said that she had her daughter because she wasn't feeling good. And so we called her, and we prayed for her over the phone, and she felt much better. She could just feel God's presence with her, and
started leaving. She was on muscle relaxers. She was all curled up and couldn't stand the pain. I believe it was in her back.
Yeah.
Anybody's ever had a bad backache, they'll appreciate that.
Yeah. Yeah. And
the other one is our friend Jim, that's been on here a couple times, wanted to bless us. There's a scratch and dent store up on 210 north of town.
Yeah.
And they had a stainless steel grill that the guy's, it's been sitting there for a while, and it's missing a tank and regulator. We got a tank and regulator and old grill. And you asked the guy how much it was, $20. So we went up and picked that up, but it wasn't the grill that we were sending there. God's kind of sneaky. And like, hey, there's a stainless steel grill that's never been used. It's been sitting outside there because it was missing some parts. You know, it's probably a $500 grill.
Yeah.
So, you know, them stainless ones ain't very cheap.
All right.
So we get there, and he was telling about this weird guy that got hit by lightning. I introduced myself and the miracles. So this lady says, oh, I got a tumor on the side of her jaw, and they're going to cut the side of her face open and try to biopsy it and find out if it was cancer or not. I said, well, we can't have that, but I really don't want to cause a scene here in your store. You know, usually where we go, there's something happens. So we went into her office, and within a couple minutes, the pain left. And the thing started getting smaller. I'm believing that it's going to be totally gone.
Yeah.
We haven't heard back yet.
Mm-hmm.
I told her if she had any more pain or anything to call back, that we were not going to let the devil win.
Yep. And
go ahead. Just everywhere we go, we don't get to share all of them.
Mm-hmm.
There's some of them are personal that people don't want us to share.
Sure.
We usually ask people, because some of them are pretty embarrassing. And
yeah, sometimes we just say their first name or not at all, because, you know, that's just how it is. But
we've had so many, we've lost track of some. We find out, oh, my God, we forgot about this one after the show. And another thing I wanted you to tell the viewers, just have you ever had time, one of our meetings, whether it was at home at the church, we didn't have fun?
Oh, absolutely not. You know, I could leave from your place at 2:00 in the morning, you know, and have to be up at 5:00, and the Lord refreshes me, and I'm not tired at all when I get up. You know, the Lord's good.
Yeah.
He's good. You know, just real quick, another thing. About 3 weeks ago, I was out putting out deer stands, and I had this little handsaw that's used for cutting small branches, and I had on a pair of leather gloves. And I was pulling this branch down in that saw, and I was sawing it, and that saw got stuck in the branch, and I jerked that saw. Well, it jerked through the branch and went through my glove and cut my index finger just above the middle knuckle there.
Mm-hmm.
And blood was coming out of the glove, you know, and one of my buddies that was with me said, did you look at it yet? I said, no. He said, well, let's look at it. So I pulled the glove off, and it sliced it pretty deep.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, what do you think? I said, oh, I ain't worried about it. I'll just put the glove back on because we had more deer stands to put out, you know. So about half hour later, it just really got to hurting bad, you know. And one of the other guys said, let me see your finger. So I pulled the glove off, and it had swole up really big, and it was just throbbing all the way down to the bone.
Uh-oh.
And I said, well, you guys probably be taking me to the hospital if I hadn't had that glove, you know. And the glove was kind of loose-fitting, but I put the glove back on, and I thought, you know, I'm not going to tell them, but I think when I get home, I'm going to take a shower, and I'm just going to go up to the hospital and get some stitches and this, you know, but I wasn't going to tell them that. So I got home and took the glove off and got in the shower and washed the blood off, and that cut had completely healed shut.
Oh. Thank you, God.
Completely healed shut within an hour.
He's so good.
Yeah.
We just never know what he's going
to
do, do
you know,
we?
And I didn't even think to pray about it.
And
you
forgot to tell us about that one.
Well, I think maybe I did, and you guys were really busy. Oh. It was
one day before
church and a lot of stuff going on. So.
Yeah.
But, you know, and like I said, I didn't even think to pray about it, that the Lord would heal that. But
he just did.
I didn't have to pray about it. And I tell everybody now, you can't hardly see where it's at. You can kind of see where it's at on my
just
hand.
Just barely, yeah.
But yeah, I tell everybody about that.
So yeah.
I tell everybody about everything the Lord does for me,
whether
they want to hear it or not. So.
Well, what we've found out that the more you brag on the miracles that Jesus has done in the past, the more he does in the future. It's like planting a seed. It just starts spreading and spreading and spreading.
Yeah.
It's not we're bragging about ourselves. We're bragging on what the Lord does. And it just multiplies, and he loves that.
It's actually one
of the neatest forms of worship. Because if you know me at all, I don't sing and dance like these other people.
And there's one thing that we just, you know, we pray for people to get healed all the time. And you know what? Now we're starting to pray for our finances because, you know, they're not where they should be, and we're just expecting a miracle. And you know what? God wants us to ask for whatever we need. And so it's like, okay, I guess it's about time to start really, and not just praying, but believing. We believe for healing all the time.
Yeah.
And so we're believing for financial breakthrough. So the reason I say that is just for other people to know that they can have that too.
Amen.
We believe in what all God's going to do for them. So we just want to remind you, again, thank you for coming, and thank you, God, for letting us be able to be here. And so next week, we hope to see you from 9 to 10, and we have different guests every week. And hope to see you on Sunday night at our next meeting, 6 o'clock, the World Revival Church from Kansas City. It was the Smithson Outpouring previously. So thanks for joining us, and you guys have a wonderful evening. Listen for God's voice.